Okay, so Tanita has very kindly come to talk to us. Tanita is the Director of Research Strategy and Policy, the Director of the Research Strategy and Policy Unit at the University of Oxford, and she's going to be talking to us today about research culture, keeping it simple. Thank you, Tanita.
Thank you, Emily, and hello, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. So I've called this talk Research Culture, Keeping It Simple. And that's not to say that I think research culture is simple, either to understand or to try to make any changes to. Implementing changes is incredibly complicated, but the argument I'd like to make is that we make it more complicated than it needs to be. And that actually by taking a simpler approach, we stand to make changes more effectively and more efficiently, and actually more sustainably. So changing culture, not just now, but actually for a bit more into the future. So as Emily said, I work at Oxford, but actually what I'm about to say isn't really necessarily linked tightly to anything that happens at Oxford. It's based on my experience at Oxford, my experience previously at the University of Glasgow on working on research culture, and the many, many people I've spoken to across the sector in universities, in funding, in associations and so on, both giving advice and gratefully receiving it. When it comes to research culture, I think we have made progress. If I was giving this talk 5 or 6 years ago, we would still be listing all the different problems that we perceive with research culture, and we would be frustrated about the fact that these are not being listened to or acknowledged or appropriately dealt with. And I think we have therefore made progress. The argument has been won. Research culture is not as positive as we wish it to be, or as positive as we need it to be for the good of research and the good of researchers. And there is a large and unassailable body of evidence that you can all go and read as to what the issues are. So from that point of view, I am not going to be listing the various problems. This is going to be quite an implementation-focused talk about what we can actually do to address the research cultures in whatever sphere of influence that we have as individuals, group leaders, institutions, or national committee members. So there's no theory here. It's all really about practicalities. So I said I wasn't going to talk about the problems, but I thought I would spend one slide telling us how I articulate the problem with a view to saying, well, this is how I think we could go about addressing some of the issues. And I've depicted it here. You may or may not agree either with this or anything else I'm going to say, but there's some ideas at least to critique. So I think for a good few years now, what we've been seeing is the sorts of things that are good for research, behaviors, incentive, environments, have diverged from the sorts of things that are good for research careers. And these two things being moving in slightly different directions causes that fracture which we experience as the problems in our research culture. And so our job at one level, if we want to conceptualize it, is this one. How do we bring more in line the things that are good for the research endeavor as a whole and the things that are experienced by the research community more generally? I'm not just talking about researchers here, but the various members of the research community. So what I mean in specific terms, and this list is not exhaustive, but just to give you an idea. So what's good for research? People coming together to work on a shared problem or question, people with diverse backgrounds and skills, knowledge, perspectives, so that new ideas can emerge and new research processes can emerge. That those researchers work together in a spirit of rigor and openness and transparency and trust. We do research to build on other research a lot of the time, and we need the shoulders of those giants to be pretty solid and trustworthy. And we want to create an environment in which people who are participating in that research do so positively, inclusively, where their ideas are accepted and where their contributions are fairly evaluated. So that's, as I said, it's not an exhaustive list, but that's the sort of thing that we might imagine is good for research. Now, what is good, in inverted commas, for research careers? It's churning stuff out, right? Getting the stuff out, you know, typically the publications, making sure that those publications are as novel, as groundbreaking, as we can stretch reality to mean. It's not really about the collective or the contribution. It's typically a bit too much about the individual. We also tend to have a bit of an image of what the traditional researcher looks like and generate copies of those. rather than think about the sorts of different activities, perspectives, skills, attitudes that we need in the research community. And we tend to evaluate research based on narrow indicators that typically are loosely connected to what we might regard as research quality. So as I said, there's probably other things we can add there, but that's how I conceptualize the problem and therefore how I go about thinking about how we might address some of these issues and turn this dial. And turning the dial is, I think, an operative phrase here. You know, research culture, we're impatient. You know, research culture is experienced by individuals and we want to fix it. And we want the switch. And if it was easy and if it was quick, we would have done it. We're really looking at how do we turn the dial consistently and confidently and hopefully in a coordinated manner across the different parts of the sector. So if that's the problem, then what's the solution? And we are not short of solutions. I now know the formula, if I had to get this to work. Okay. These are the solutions, right? So this slide is meant to look like a bit of a nightmare. And what this is the well-meaning and actually incredibly professional and useful documents that have come from different parts of the sector that aim to support, enable, encourage the different parts of the sector to improve research culture. I won't go through this in detail. But basically what you've got are sector reports, surveys, evidence base. We've got funder assurance mechanisms, funder policies, national committees, inquiries, consultations. We've got national evaluation exercises, community principles, and that's obviously just a small list, and then a large number of sector concordats and sector agreements, and you might be familiar with many of these. We've just heard about the Concordat on Research Integrity. We heard earlier from your Vice Chancellor about DORA, and then others like Athena Swan, the Technician Commitment, and so on. So I'm saying this because there are solutions out there that have been proposed, but they are quite demanding in some senses, but also quite fragmented. As I said earlier, as researchers, we experience culture in our midst, but actually we need to also be mindful of the context that many of research leaders, your PI, people in research offices, your Pro-Vice Chancellor for Research, the environment in which they are operating. That's number one, just that awareness. But also a lot of these things can act as levers for the sorts of things that you might like to do locally. And so being aware of them also gives you the pretext to lean on them when you're trying to make arguments for what needs to change. Now, this fragmentation is, as you can see, quite complicated because we're trying to change one thing, culture, and yet we've got a whole bunch of stuff out there. And if I was to caricature some of the responses to all of that sea of advice, I would characterize it in these two ways, right? One is this one here, which is the paralysis that comes with so many things that need to be done. And sometimes the criticism is leveled at, say, Pro-Vice Chancellors for Research for virtue signaling, because they say they want stuff done, and of course they absolutely do, and then folk don't actually see them moving to the next phase, which is the action and the change seen on the ground. But there's another approach, which I think is equally unhelpful, which is this one here, which is that we generate action plans to support individual strands of activity, for example, aligning to some of the priority areas in the previous slide, but are actually, when all considered and added up, are not actually addressing culture itself. What they're doing is optimizing individual strands of activity. And so what I mean there, you might have a whole bunch of people focused on the Research Integrity Concordat, one on open research, one on open data, one on Athena Swan, one on researcher careers, one on DORA, one on evaluation, and so on. And I'd argue then that optimizing each of these strands is not the most efficient, effective, or sustainable way, never mind, very clear, way of supporting improvements in research culture. So I've tried to simplify it here, and I will go through each of these steps in the next few slides. The first action I would say is to be very focused and in defining what you mean by research culture in the area in which you are working. It won't be the same everywhere. Andrew spoke earlier about different disciplines having different needs, and I'll show some evidence from that from a survey that we did in Glasgow. This is an absolutely important fundamental prerequisite for embarking on any research culture improvement activities. Be action focused and align the actions. It's not this, that, the other. It's, well, if you really are focused and that's really what you want to change, then ensure that your policies, your support structures, your reward mechanisms your training, your communications, and what you celebrate are aligned to ensuring the outcomes that you want to. Think sustainably. I've been involved in lots of projects around research culture that are fixing the problem for now, that are coming in and intervening on something, but not thinking about how that will be embedded in the how we do things around here culture of your area. Over-communicate, that's probably the kind of advice that we would give to anything at all, but you're not communicating as much as you think you are. And a lot of projects, not just culture projects, are only known by the people who are working on it because they talk and think about it and breathe it all the time. But it needs to get to the people that are going to not only benefit from those actions, but are going to amplify your message and amplify your actions. And then think carefully about who you're working with, and I'll talk more about that later. Okay, so here we go. Defining research culture. I'm not going to ask anybody what they think the definition of research culture is, because it is incredibly complicated. And actually, as I said, it's bespoke to the area that you're working on. Be very specific. So here I've given one sort of classification. It's just something that I've done based on my experience of conversations around research culture. But it's not absolutely everything. Okay, so there are things that will make your lives better. The parking, the catering, the cycle paths, all that sort of stuff. But actually, I would argue that's not your job. There are organisational cultural elements which absolutely touch on research culture or come in a different, more broad variant than research culture. But again, don't really fall, or if you were being very selective about it, don't fall into the realm of research culture. I would argue that research culture is very tightly related, or should be tightly related, to the process of how research is done. So the practices that we undertake, how those practices are assessed, so what does that mean for the career of the individual and for what they're valued for doing, and then how that actually directly relates to that person's research career. So make it very tightly linked to the everyday practice of doing research, which everybody in the research community would have experience of, and therefore is also in a position to change. Now, even when you've done that, you still end up with a whole bunch of stuff. Again, there's more I could have put on here, right? So let's imagine we've now focused in on research culture, and we've got all sorts of things here. We've got reproducibility, open research, fair evaluation, team research, and so on. It's still not helping us get away from the 1,000 action plans. So here's how I try to rationalize research culture. And as I said, it's not simple. We just heard from Andrew how complicated just research integrity is. So we're not going to be making it incredibly simple. But this is how I think about it. There are three sort of main categories of activity around research culture. One is research practice. How do we enable, support researchers to do research that's reliable, reproducible, transparent? Okay, ethical research that's open, transparent, and reproducible. The second bin is around recognising that research needs different talents and skills, that it needs activities of different types, and in the case of outputs and publications, also outputs of different types, and that all of these contribute to the research endeavour as a whole. And then if we want to encourage these behaviours and want to support them, then researchers need to also be valued in career terms for doing what we think are the right things. So how do we therefore embed valuing contributions and research practice within the career framework and ensure that we are therefore evaluating research fairly? And we can then think about those little bubbles, our little activities that happen under each of these pillars that are aligned to those values. And we align the actions that we have to support each of these pillars, which in this case are policies. So the university says they want you to do stuff, the support. So what training is available, what systems make those behaviors easier, which incentives are provided, and then fundamentally, what are the rewards for doing the right thing? So that actually we don't have researchers paying a career tax for doing what we know is right, when in actual fact, the career structure is pointing in a different direction. So that's about definitions. Now about actions rather than just policies. Policies are necessary, they're just not enough to get from where we want to take culture to what people are actually doing. And it's very easy, I think, to agree with values and ambitions. You know, we want a research culture that is fair, supportive, based on blah, blah, right? Very, very easy. What it doesn't allow you to do is to communicate what you want to happen tomorrow that's different from what we're doing today. So research culture starts tomorrow, that's your plan. What are folk doing? And that's why I'm going to focus on actions, because those are the ones that are going to bring about sustained change. And aligning your actions helps to demonstrate that you really mean it and that you're putting all of your effort and resources behind it. So what are you supporting, what are you rewarding, and what are you celebrating? And so I've got a number of practical actions that are attached to perhaps some values and ambitions that we have around research culture based on the experience I've had in running this in more than one institution. So your Vice-Chancellor this morning mentioned that you had signed DORA last year. I think DORA is a good example of where everyone's heard of it, everyone knows we need to respect its commitments, but it's quite easy. What are we doing tomorrow that's different from today? Well, what you're not doing tomorrow is you're not using impact factors. And everyone sort of knows that. That's the second paragraph. But what are we actually doing instead then? And that's what that first bullet is meant to indicate. So at Glasgow, we wrote some conversation starters around outputs, as in, what are you therefore talking about when you want to evaluate research quality? At Oxford, we've generated some implementation principles around DORA that sits alongside our commitment to DORA. So again, it's about actions and it's about what you would like people to do rather than what you would like people to believe in. The second point is around, we value contributions. How do we value contributions? Well, we record them in some shape or form. So here, there was a project we did at Glasgow to embed the credit taxonomy within our outputs repository, and that allows collaborators on an output to declare in a small number of words what their role was within that publication. And that can then be transposed over to annual appraisals, recruitment, fellowship recruitment, promotions, and so on. But the first step is being able to capture it so that you can then both identify it and evaluate it. And if you're in a position to be making more structural changes, then valuing contributions also means not expecting everybody to follow the traditional PI career track. So what are the alternative career tracks, bioinformaticians, statisticians, research scientists, research software engineers, that you could be having alongside other research careers? The Careers Concordat supports career development for fixed-term researchers in particular, and it allows them at least 10 days of continuous professional development. Postdocs, fixed-term researchers clearly are very aware of the Concordat and would like to benefit from the commitments that the university has made, but what is the support there for the PIs who are actually delivering that support? So how is the support being delivered, for example, in understanding what 10 days of CPD looks like? What are the conversation starters with your postdoc about what it is that the next career stage will be? How is that support being provided? We know that many of our early career staff will be going on to roles outside of academia. Are we doing enough to track what those destinations are and use that intelligence back to inform support for careers for our postdocs? And then how do we embed equitable assessment within our own schemes, for example, our funding schemes or in recruitment? If we value a broader range of activities than the ones that are awarded at the moment, grants and publications, what do those look like? What does quality look like? And how do we then implement them locally? And you don't have to do that at institutional level, that could be at local level as well. Appointing local leadership, we heard earlier about the Open Research Champions as well. That also signals that there is responsibility and someone to go to, not because they know everything, but because they can then signpost to other areas. And then using opportunities, I suppose in this case from COVID, to think, well, how do we address problems with culture that have occurred as a result of the pandemic? So that was about support. I also want to talk about rewarding what we value, because for those who want to do research in a rigorous, open, transparent manner and support those around them, they'll do it anyway. There's a whole bunch of others that can absolutely be persuaded by ensuring that actually the university, our organisations, our funders are serious about rewarding what they are talking about. And so at Glasgow a few years ago, we actually worked to update our promotions criteria. And we had these five different things we wanted to achieve. The first is to give parity of credit for outputs and impact, so that essentially you were getting the same credit, whether you were delivering impact or what offered the publications. And that was sort of there already. It wasn't a huge departure, but it was made explicit. We also gave credit for collegiality. And by collegiality, we mean supporting the careers of others. And so back to the theme of what does that actually mean, it means things like including earlier stage academics as co-investigators on funding bids, acting as the second supervisor, where the more junior researcher was the primary supervisor, nominating others for peer recognition, sponsoring researchers and allowing them access to your networks and so on. So you didn't have to tick a list. It was like, these are the sorts of things that we would get reward for. We wanted to favor quality over quantity and therefore encouraged the use of 100 word descriptors around outputs and only ask for a small number of outputs in promotion paperwork and recruitment paperwork and so on. Where some of the descriptors were of a quantitative type, we would also ask for a mix of quantitative and qualitative so that it was possible for the individual putting forward their case to describe what impact their activities had. And we also required evidence of a commitment to open research. And so that was put in place, as I said, a few years ago. And this is just an example of saying, well, if this is what we're saying we want, how do we make it happen within the reward framework? And so I've taken here sort of individual strands and tried to sort of collate them, but there are specific ways in which we can intervene at the crossroads of all of these different activities. And I would say that trying to transform, I don't know, peer review is one aspect of that. How is research and researchers being judged? And if we tweak that, if we turn the dial on peer review, then actually we start to change the way in which we recruit, the way in which we promote, the people we collaborate with, and those that we reward, whether that's through grants and through prizes. And there's one tool that you may well be familiar with, which is the narrative CV. So the narrative CV is a CV format that's being either used or piloted by at least half of the UK funders, and it's being adopted in various forms in international funders as well. And if you haven't come across it, what it does, it provides a structured format for a researcher to describe the contributions and the achievements that they have made in specific areas that are much broader than the ones that we currently value. And this is, in summary, what it looks like. So it basically has four main modules. One to describe the generation of knowledge, so how has the individual contributed to the generation of knowledge? How have they contributed to the development of others? So back to the sort of collegiality that I just spoke about. How have they contributed to the wider research community? So national committees, for example, or local leadership roles, for example, in supporting equity or culture or integrity. And how have you contributed to broader society? So a decision, I suppose, has been made in bringing together the narrative CV that these are the core pillars of what we expect a researcher to be able to demonstrate. It's specifically stated that it's their contributions that are being asked for. And there's a range here of things, of which probably the first one is the one that we are most familiar with, but the others are an expansion towards other areas of activities. Another way of intervening at the crossroads of these different priorities is to pull together what I've called here a ways of working document, or a lab philosophy document, or a how we work document. And there are a few examples of these around, which I'll link to in a minute. But when you join a lab, a group, a department, there are lots of things that are true about the culture of that department that aren't captured anywhere, and that people don't tend to ask. For example, who decides the authorship list? Who decides where the ideas come from? How do ideas get challenged? Who chooses the collaborators around here? What funding is available? What's your approach to career development? And so the idea that some have had and that have developed or given advice for is to bring this together in the sorts of document that allows a PI, a department, an institute at whatever level to make the implicit explicit, so that when a new member of the lab joins, or indeed existing members are thinking about some of these things, they know the way we do things around here. And of course, this can be a collective exercise. It doesn't have to be done by one person within the group. I do suggest you read at least the first article of the first article of these, because it gives you lots of different examples of how that could be done. And it's something that can be done in anyone's sphere, I think. Okay, evaluate how you're doing and plan for the long term. This starts with setting out what the priorities are of your area. Occasionally what I find is I speak to someone and they go, well, the leadership here needs fixing, so we'll bring somebody in, do a leadership course, and then that's us sorted. Not quite in those words, but in some ways it's almost doing a project from the middle out. So rather than starting from the beginning and saying, well, what is the issue here? What issue are people perceiving? And I think that's important for two reasons at least. One is, if you don't ask, you don't know. But second, you get a chance to ask your colleagues, what is working? First of all, because you might choose that the better approach is to improve what's already working, but also you might inadvertently throw out the thing that's working because you never heard about it in the first place in the process of fixing the problem that you seem to have approached. So a survey is one way of doing it. I think there are lots of surveys already out there, open source, around research culture, so don't reinvent a survey if that's what you want to do. You can do it much more informally in town hall or workshops, and that can follow on from the survey if you wish to. As I mentioned earlier, many of the priorities can be aligned to sector policies and drivers, whether it's REF, Athena Swan, and many of the other things that I showed earlier on. And start from what you know about your community and what you know to be true. But also think really carefully about who you're going to be working with, because you may have identified your best project, the one that's the most relevant, and you haven't got a team to deliver it. So I would suggest that you run with your second best project with the best team, then you wait around cajoling people to support you on the project that you were leading on. And this is an example of survey results from a survey that we conducted in Glasgow a few years ago. And I just want to make a few points based on the survey. So it was quite a short survey, and we ran it across each of the departments. What you'll see here is the rows of the questions, and the columns are each of the departments. So I just wanted to highlight these two departments. And blue is more favourable comments, red is least favourable comments. So this is making the point that actually there isn't one culture within your organisation. Okay, there are many cultures. So here you have a department in blue that goes, yeah, I know about all this stuff, thanks very much. And a red one that goes, no, actually, I just have a clue, thanks. So this is an eye-opener, and you can see variations on that as you look across the columns. These two rows at the bottom are actually highlighting two particular questions, one around good authorship practice and whether that is understood, and whether individuals feel that they are able to undertake CPD. So again, a lot of people seem to be quite comfortable with the notion of good authorship practice, but very few feel that there are time available to spend undertaking CPD. Now that told us a couple of things. One is we had been banging on about integrity for years at Glasgow, so we had already put a lot of effort into making visible the policies, the support. We'd built in a network of champions. I sort of tend to believe that actually they knew what good authorship practice, at least had heard enough of it to say, yes, I know, and less so about CPD. The other thing that this told us is that actually, at what level do some of these actions need to be? If the CPD issue is something that's happening right across the institution, then maybe that's an institutional level project to be undertaken, unlike some of the others that perhaps are a bit more localized. So there's information that you can get out of these things. It's not just about what do we focus on, but also how variable is this issue? Where is the right level of intervention for this particular problem? So I'm not going to say much about communication because it's sort of self-evident. But it does, what is the purpose of it? The purpose of it is for, obviously, to get attention, but also for others to amplify your message and amplify your actions. So many people, even these days, wanting to support a research culture programme, tend to be relatively isolated and need to make friends. And what you don't want to be is in a position where you're forever shouting and needing to increase the reach of your message. What you want to do is enlist others to work for you. The focus of the first slide is important, because actually if you've got more than one message, then others, then they're going to be lost along the way. And although this probably shouldn't need saying, are the people that are closest to you, do they know what's going on? As I said, sometimes there can be individuals who've got it all in their heads, know what they're doing, and actually there aren't the people around them who can speak for them. Being open and reporting publicly on plans and on progress is helpful for all sorts of reasons, not just for accountability, but actually because we can share better across the sector. And not to forget that although we obsess a bit with cascades and emails and newsletters and so on internally, that communicating to the outside world is actually very, very effective and can reach your internal audiences. And I've just put here a little timeline from the University of Newcastle, just by illustration. Who is in your team? So I'll take this moment to pause and thank everybody who I do work with, and this is the Oxford crowd, but I thank the Glasgow crowd as well. Governance. So I only have one thing to say about governance. Clearly, you need some sort of governance, but I would really be disinclined to recommend that culture becomes a sideshow to the normal business of what research quality means and how research is governed. So as much as possible, and although it's tempting to go, I need this thing over here called culture so that I've got all these folk that care about culture, maybe resist that temptation, or at least have an eye for how culture can be integrated into the normal process of doing research, supporting researchers, creating an environment in which research and researchers are supported. Delivery, and this is back to that scary slide at the beginning. We need to work across the boundaries of the organisation or the department, job families, etc., to support a better culture. It's not enough to say, well, I'm the integrity expert, I'm going to do integrity, I'm the equity expert, I'm going to do that. It's really about what are those core priorities, you know, what does peer review look like, what does fair evaluation look like, and get those actions coordinated so that we're only doing things once and making them count for all the various ambitions that we have. And also not to forget that the team that you're working with also includes the rest of the sector. It could be the funder, it could be the committees, it could be the learned society, because actually, in the same way that we don't want different parts of our organisation fulfilling different ambitions, we don't want the sector to be deviating and going in different directions. We work across the boundaries of every part of the sector. And here's an example of a report that we published here at Oxford a couple of weeks ago, and that's Jenny, my collaborator and co-author there, and the lead author actually on this project. And this was a project to look at the barriers to equitable and inclusive access to research funding. Okay, so research funding is spread highly unevenly, and some marginalised groups have unequal access to funding. And so this was a project in which not only did we document what the barriers were, but actually looked at what the recommendations could be. And the recommendations were not just recommendations, they were recommendations for universities, recommendations for funders, and recommendations that needed to be decided on jointly between those two sets of parts of the sector. And so we will be convening those sector discussions with universities and funders with a view to identifying solutions that work across those different domains. So I'll just to summarise then, there are five different steps that I think can be helpful in articulating and then supporting and bringing people together to change culture within our organisations, but also interacting more broadly. I think this is a really good time to be trying to address our problems with research culture. As you've seen, a lot of sector interest, a lot of investment is going into research, and a lot of interest from the funders is going into how our research is done and how our researchers are looked after, not just by institutions, but by the PIs. There are lots of tools, systems that enable open, transparent research, and that we therefore should embrace them. And probably more importantly, there's lots of goodwill across the sector to work collaboratively. And therefore, I would really urge us all to think outside of what we do, where we can combine our efforts with those of others so that we can all change culture for the better in the right direction. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Tanita. We will have time for questions, but I'll just quickly take the floor just because some of the things that Tanita talked about, we have got displayed in our research culture poster, which is in the foyer. So please do have a look. You'll find out information about the web pages we've put together about the narrative CV and about authorship, among other things. So any questions from the audience? Any on Zoom, Katie? Yes.
What do you define by impact?
I'll just repeat the question. What do you define by impact?
So in the context of evaluating researcher activities, we're talking here about societal impact, which is to say the impact and change on public policy, on health, on business, and so on, that derives from academic activities.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Thank you for the very interesting talk. I wondered if you could comment on the extent that you feel some of the programs like Athena Swan and the other EDI-related activities are research culture specific enough or not enough? Which direction and what the strength of that relationship should be?
Yeah, I think they provide a very, very useful and productive substrate on which to overlay the more researcher-specific elements of this. So I would say that a lot of the activities that I've described here fit very well within an Athena Swan framework. The narrative CV, things like the credit taxonomy, the how we work sort of structures, and of course the equitable access to research funding. So they fit quite nicely. I think, you know, my experience of working with colleagues who work on Athena Swan is that Athena Swan can co-opt many of the things that we are doing more broadly in research culture, and they fit quite neatly within what they wish to do. But of course, all the things that sit around that are equally important to be drawn on, but they're useful for the other community as well. So I think they fit together nicely.
Great, thank you. We've got two questions up there. I think Dan's hand was up first, and then the one in front. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. You mentioned at the end working across sectors and working with a funder in particular. And I think that's key, and we have a tendency sometimes to blame the funder and perhaps vice versa. So I was wondering if you could just expand a bit on what that would look like. How can we work with funders better?
Yeah. So the Equity Report is one example, but it's absolutely in no way isolated. I think the Narrative CV provides another example. I think the reason I think that the connection is important, for example, for the Equity Report, you know, the funders will put out their statistics around their award and application and success rates, but actually they can't do anything about it if we don't support those who are applying. So in that respect, we need to work jointly, because if that is an agenda that we wish to work on, then we need both sides of it to join up at the right place. The other reason and way in which we need to work together is that there may be priorities that the institutions know how to implement, or know what can be implemented or what can't be implemented. So better dialogue around not just what's possible, but what's possible. So let's think about, I don't know, environmental sustainability, which I didn't mention as part of culture. Clearly, there are imperatives from across other parts of the sector, you know, Treasury, whatever, government, to do something about it. What is it that universities can do, as opposed to being given a set of priorities that we then somehow have to implement? So how can we work together to put it at the right pace, at the right set of ambition, rather than, you know, maybe come in too late or not be able to advise on how we can embrace some of the priorities? It's not because we don't want to, it's just that sometimes it's very difficult because of systems, because of behaviours, because of structures, and because of the ways in which we can persuade researchers to change. The other thing is also, as I said earlier, there are lots of different cultures. And I think it would within an institution, and I think it's not appropriate actually to impose a single culture, and that culture for a discipline will be determined by their discipline rather than by the institution. So actually, so much of our cultures span across boundaries anyway, for example, in linkages with learned societies. So they're just there, and we just haven't harnessed them. But I think the things are happening. I'm not criticising. I think there's just we need to identify what it is and then do it, as opposed to speak in general terms. And that's what some of this stuff is.
Thank you. And the other question, thank you.
Thank you very much for giving this very interesting talk. So my question is around, you mentioned the importance of recognition. There has been cases, probably in different institutions, that people's contribution, for example, towards a development of a proposal, was not recognized, that these people were, in the end, not included as a co-I in the proposal. And when this happened, it caused a lot of damage in trust, and also a lot of hurt to the colleagues who were excluded. I wonder if you have recommendations on how to prevent such things from happening, and how an institution could take effective actions to promote and encourage inclusiveness.
Yeah. And this is probably back into the research integrity sphere, but I would say it's the same sort of discussions that need to happen at the outset of publications, which is a planning phase, which actually starts defining who is going to do what, and therefore what role they were going to play. And there's a blurry line between doing that, sticking it in a drawer, and then treating that as the truth, as opposed to reviewing it on a regular basis to ensure that those contributions and those are still true. So the challenge here is that you can absolutely say, do it once, do it well, have that step, but that doesn't quite take us to the solution that I think we want. So I think the behavior change is, let's put in a planning, a rigorous planning stage that basically says, who do we need in this project? You know, what do we know about this project? Who needs to be involved? And who are the identities of the people involved? And what are they doing? And how they're going to be credited? And then that document gets reviewed on a regular basis. That would be my recommendation. And actually, if there was something like how we work document, as I recommended here, that could be one part of it. How is contribution determined? How do we do things around here in determining people's roles? But it can't be cast in stone because things change, projects change, the direction of the project change, and sometimes those intentions don't fall through.
Thank you. Do we have any? Yeah. Okay, so this is from Emma Ream. How much in your experience is local culture influenced by local, i.e. department, school level, activity to improve culture versus university institution approach?
Yeah, so it's huge, but it's also, I think, dependent on what aspect of culture. So when I showed the survey earlier, there was a bit of that stratification. So the policies need to be central. What is it that we support? What is it that people can go for support? But for example, for questions like, what does a good publication look like in my discipline? That's definitely a local culture. Seminar series that involve all members of the research community, that's a local culture. So I think some of the priorities and some, I often think of it in terms of how many things need to be done once, how many things need to be done five times, how many things need to be done 50 times, if that's a number of departments, and to almost consciously think about what that is. So priorities are set, and I think some of the could be set sort of at institutional level, but all of the implementation, or most of the implementation, is local. And so that's where the picking and choosing happens, and where the implementation happens around things that are specifically around the practice of that area.
Great, thank you. Did we have another one? Okay, so the comment from Renee J saying, very good presentation and also helpful in wider organisational environment, not only academic activities. I don't know if you want to respond to that in any way.
I think all of this applies across the research community, right? Mm-hmm. So the values that we put in place to support fixed-time researchers are the same as we do for technicians and for professional services staff. And actually, it's probably unhelpful to think about these as distinct groups, mm-hmm. because the boundaries are starting to be blurred. And so talking about research culture for the community in which the support is for everyone in their different ways gets us away from compartmentalizing roles and just accepting actually that the values for research integrity, for example, or career support ought to apply to everyone.
Thank you. I really appreciated the focus on practical kind of actions in your talk, throughout your talk, and also the focus on cross-sector interactions. In a similar vein to the question about funding, are there actions that you think publishers could take to support this work?
I suppose, I used to work in publishing. I didn't actually say why I'm here or what I do, but I think they can do a lot to ensure that our practices are reinforced, particularly around research, around data availability statements, around credit, around the transparency of different parts of the process, of accepting, pre-registration, and so on. They can encourage open peer review, and so on. So those are, although they somewhat come at sort of end point, if they are there, and if they are consistent across publishers, and if they're policed, then that does count as one of the levers, strong rationales for ensuring engagement with the support and training that's provided within an institution. So it provides a focus and a reason. It's not that everyone needs that kind of incentive, but we have a community that is driven by all sorts of different things. And so the more things that help one, take those actions, I have no ethical quibble with that.
Great, thank you very much. I think we might have reached the end of our questions. Any more on Zoom? No? Okay, so thank you very much, Tanita.